Doctor, you are welcome to Nigeria. The most popular black African country in Africa, on the continent of Africa. We want to know, what was your impression when you landed in Nigeria last night?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It was a dream for me to come to Nigeria a long time ago. And alhamdulillah, Allah made it a reality. And we landed last night before midnight. And Nigeria is a very resourceful, very rich country. But unfortunately, the people are not as rich as the country itself. This could be because of many reasons. Like you can see, the young boys now clearing the water or making a canal in a very primitive way, despite the country is a very rich and very resourceful country.
Thank you very much, Doctor. The next question is, as you have come, you have seen Nigeria being one of the largest the largest populated country in our continent of Africa. And now if you look at the distribution of resources by the headquarters to their various offices, and you found out that it does not commensurate with the size and the population of this country. So if you get back to Kuwait, I don't know what would be your take on this, or what is your advice on this?
Most of the organizations are sometimes controlled by two things: the donors that they give money, and the quality of the projects that being actually raised or planned by the local offices. So with a lot of conflicts happening worldwide, unfortunately, like happening in Syria, in Yemen, with the Uyghur, in China, with the Rohingya in Myanmar and Bangladesh, and with South Sudan conflict, with conflict in Democratic Republic of Congo, the problem also of climate change affecting people, the problem of Somalia as well. All this, as United Nations classifying them, is giving them category 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So you might not find a country like Nigeria or others when it would like to lift the people up from poverty or ignorance to a different level. The challenges against any headquarter is governed by the level of problems affecting humanity on earth at the moment, as well as the mentality of the local donors who actually raise the fund locally, or the drive of the international community where they want to put their money in. The international community does not give a priority to Nigeria because it's not a number one conflict zone, despite the fact there's a problem of security in Nigeria, but it's not compared to Syria, it's not compared to Yemen, it's not compared to what's happening in Central African Republic with anti-Balaka, with ethnic cleansing there. That's why the problem is, the challenge is let the local office to produce a very dynamic, effective program to enable the headquarters to market for it against all these challenges. These are the challenges with any headquarters.
Thank you very much, sir. As you are listening to the director of International Islamic Charity Organization Nigeria office, Sheikh Abdul Wasir, he told you that IRCO Nigeria office is really facing the problem of physical structure projects like mosques, block of classrooms, boreholes, surface wells. These have been some of the problems we are facing, and for many years they don't give us. So what advice will you give the office and the director, and what advice will you give to us, your headquarters and Kuwait?
I think the project you mentioned, it is very good, but we need to move from that to another project as well, which is the resilience of the local community, to build the resilience of the local community, as well as to take them to the livelihood. Like when you look at Nigeria, look at on the right hand side and left hand side, the greenery of Nigeria. There's a lot of rich land, fertile land in Nigeria, as well as no shortage of water yet in Nigeria. And manpower is there, human resources is there. So the easiest project which can live, which can make any organization sustainable, is livelihood, particularly agriculture projects. Based on agriculture, we can build local economy, we can build local capacity, we can build local market, and we can build local industry. Even if you start as manual industry, as handicraft, as all, see, look at on the, my right hand side, all these beautiful black fertile soil with the green vegetation coming from it. That means that we need to encourage our headquarters and our donors to invest in local agriculture and livelihood projects, to find a local job or to create a local job for the local community. Then the second step after that, the local community will be able to build their own mosques, as you can see on the right hand side here, their own church, their own school, their own madrasa, and so on and so on. But without having an income or a job for the local community, we are actually going to be depending on a donor which actually might control not only the local office but the headquarters. Because most of the donors that actually we rely on are very traditional. They believe in certain projects only. But I want, and you need, to get those donors to understand how can we build the farm, how can we build the market, how can we build an economy, how can we build jobs for young people. Even in the first 5 or 10 or 20 years will be based on the manual work that we develop actually the community further, and develop the economy, develop the industry, develop the agriculture production, and so on, so on, so on, so on, so on. Try to be innovative and in your project actually to convince not only the local, not only the headquarters, but to convince the donor to give you the $5,000 for a project, or the $3,000 for a project for a family, or the $2,000 or $3,000 project for a smaller family which can actually have community farming. And this is what we need, to go out from the traditional project that we've been doing over the past into, see this beautiful scenes, this maize, brother, this maize, isn't it?
Yes, maize,
yeah, beautiful maize, what they call it, wheat and sorghum and sesame seeds, all these are coming because the climate is nice here. The land is fertile, as well as the water is plenty. And the human resources, bismillah, mashallah, plenty, as you said, more than 200 million people are living in Nigeria.
Thank you very much, sir. We, from your biography, we discovered that you have been in Dawa, in humanitarian service for many years. You have a lot of experience. You have traveled widely. From your experience as a Dai, what would be your advice to the young one how to focus on Dawa activities as a Muslim?
Thank you, brother Musa. Dawa is not one size fits all. Dawa is not one program. Dawa is not one school of thought. Dawa is not something that actually is the same that you do it everywhere. The most important element for the young people in the da'wah is the manner
of the individual who are make the da'wah. You might create hafiz, okay, of Quran, or hafiz of hadith, or hafiz of seerah, but such hafiz might not have the good manner and the good etiquette. So the most important element of da'wah is the manner, the attitude, the etiquette, and the behavior. It's no good to get me a hafiz who is corrupt, does not understand what Quran is about, or what seerah is about, or what hadith is about. So we need not only to create hafiz, but to create alim. Alim who will be able, or she will be able to understand the knowledge, as well as to implement it in the community. It's number one. Number two is the young people, men and women, has to be patient. Extremely patient. Extremely patient. And I give two examples. The examples of if I get married now, and my wife become pregnant, and my baby comes out from the womb of his mother, will I be able to send him or her to school at the age of 5 months or 10 months? Will I be able to send him or her as a baby or a child to the university? Or I'll have to be patient till he or she, as a young children, grew up to go to university and to be adult. This number one. So nothing is happening like this without being patient. Look at the big trees. It takes time. This is a mango tree, isn't it?
Yes.
On the left hand side. It's a mango tree.
Yes.
Will I be able to put the seed of the mango tree in land like this? See, it's one or two or three mango trees there. And within 1 month, it will become a fruitful tree? No, no way. It takes years. This is what I'm trying to tell. Being patient, especially when you want to build the community. That's number two. Number three is education. Education, education. Education is not only religious education. Religious education might open my heart to clean my spirit and to learn from my Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and other prophets sallallahu alaihi wasallam ajma'in. But I need, besides the religious education, with some is non-religious education in agriculture, in water management, in astronomy, in civil engineering, in education itself, in medicine, in science, in technology, because I'm building a society. I need a mechanical engineer, I need a teacher, I need a professor, I need a doctor, I need a nurse, I need astronomist, I need even a sportsman and sportswoman, I need an artist, I need a theologian, I need a thinker. We need all this besides the religious education. I want such a professional people building this beautiful building on the right hand side is to have the clean and the good heart, which come from the religious education as well. So I have to marry both of them. Number four,
yes.
Actually, we need to learn from the elderly. We should not start from zero. We should not say that actually my father was not educated, so ignore him. No, he has a knowledge, and my mother has a knowledge, or my ancestors has a knowledge, and I need to learn how did they pass and lived over the last century or so with such a knowledge. Not only we need to learn from our parents and our forefathers, but we need to learn from other communities. Other communities, whether they are Muslims or non-Muslims. Science and technology is not made for one country, for one religion. It is made for everybody. And a lot of non-Muslim countries actually are advanced in their knowledge and technology than us. So we need to learn from them. This is number five. Number six, actually, we need to respect every citizen in the society. Every citizen, because we are all the citizens of Nigeria. Whether we are Muslims or non-Muslims, whether we are Sufi or Salafi or Shia or Sunni or whatever it is, and we need to focus on how collectively we can build and protect our countries. This is number six or number five. Number seven, actually, we need to build partnership between our local organizations and governments, and between our local organization, whether a Muslim organization and a Muslim organization. Then also we need to build the bridges
between our organization and some other non-Muslim organization in the international community as well, to learn and to cross-fertilize our organization from their knowledge and experience. Number eight or seven or eight is we should not become arrogant because we speak many languages, because we have a certain certificate or degrees. Arrogance is a killer. Arrogance is a killer. We should show humility, respect, and being humble when we deal with our fellow citizens, or when we deal with the people that we claim that we are actually helping them as well. This is number eight. Number nine, actually, we should review, keep reviewing our failure and our achievement, to learn from our failure and to strengthen how to advance our achievement. So keep reviewing and analyzing and understanding why did we fail. It's not haram to fail once or twice or three times or four times, but from our failure we can create our success. So we have to learn from our failure to make the success story afterwards. Number 10 is actually we should believe all together that our country does not belong to one sector, to one sect,
yes,
one group.
Okay.
All of us are like, you know, this in the social media, in the, what do you call it, the technology of making the photographs, there's many dots.
Okay.
Okay? And the image is made out of this kind of millions and more of these smaller dots.
Yeah.
Each of our organization is like this dot. Okay?
Yes.
This dot does not represent the country. It's a part of the country. Your organization and your group is not the country, is a part of the country. The country is made out of many dots, and the country is made out of many organizations, many groups, many ideologies, many of this. It's not one size, it's not one organization, it's not one theology. Even among the Sunni, not all of them are following the same school of thought.
Mm-hmm.
You have got Hanafi, you have got Sunni, you have got Hanbali, you have got Maliki, and so on, so on, so on, so on. Even within the same school of thought, you have got different teachers. So when you look at the mosaic of this great image of the country, we have to understand that we all, as citizens of the country, belong to the country, and we all make one country. If we say that we are the country, this is a failure. This is a failure, this is a failure. And this is my message to the youth. We are not the country, we are not the nation, we are not the group. Even amongst one group, there's too many different opinions inside the same group. That's why they keep arguing with one another, which one to lead and which one to be removed from such a group.
Thank you very much, sir. Doctor, I know you are very experienced, but if you look at the world today, there are a lot of Islamic organizations in the Muslim world, but they are resourceful. But and so many Islamic organizations, but what is it that the Muslims are facing a lot of problems, especially Muslims are living object poverty, and nothing much has been done about it? What really is the problem or the cause of that?
The main problem with the Muslim organization, you might say that in Nigeria you might have 10,000 or 20,000,
yes,
or 50,000,
yes,
or 100,000 organizations,
yes,
of civil society, okay?
Yes.
If there's no coordination mechanism, if there's no collaboration, if there's no awareness of what your right hand is doing by the left hand, there'll be a lot of resources wasting. There'll be a lot of drainage to resources, and will be duplicating the same work at the same time at the same area by many organizations. Yeah. I give you some examples. If you go to MENA now, I don't know how big is MENA, and I've got 20 organizations,
yes,
or 50 organizations from Lagos or from Abuja. They want to do Kurbani project.
Okay.
And the poorest area in MENA is an area, I don't know, area, what, what's
Jida Manguru.
Sorry?
Jida Manguru, Manguru.
Jida Manguru.
Yes.
Okay? And without coordinating,
yeah,
okay, this 50 organization will go to slaughter Kurbani.
In Jida Manguru.
In Jida Manguru. Without knowing.
Yes.
So he might slaughter in one area number of animals which will make in a very short period of time abundant of meat which could be wasted, while other area of MENA did not receive any meat. And this is a very, very simple example of actually not talking to another, not sitting to another, and but unfortunately competing with one another, because each one of us would like to say we were the first organization to go to Jina, Jida Manguru, in this area. Coordination now and building partnership is like, for me, is like the kalima. If you don't say the kalima, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, you are not a Muslim. If you don't believe in coordination and the building partnership with other organizations, with other local community or other communities, you are not actually a proper civil society organization. You are an organization who is actually looking at its own interest, building its own logo, and ignoring other achievements done by others. Our failure, Brother Musa and Brother Abdul Wasa, is not in how good we are when we implement, but how bad we are when we coordinate and build bridges between us and our fellow organization. Why should I go to MENA and waste my time while another very resourceful organization working in MENA, so I can let them to work on my behalf in this area and I work on their behalf in another area? This is bridge building, this building partnership, this coordination and communication. That's why we are failing.
Thank you very much, sir. Yeah, tomorrow you will be one of the, or you are the main speaker of the program tomorrow, of the donor conference tomorrow. What is your greatest expectations?
My expectation tomorrow is to learn, not to educate and teach, to learn from the people, from the discussion. As you mentioned earlier, you have 5 or 6 problems in Nigeria. Top on the ladder is security issue with the terrorist or radical groups in the northeast. Number 2 is maybe corruption or wastage of resources because of corruption. Number 3 could be climate change, which is not affecting Nigeria but affecting Africa and different areas. Number 4 is the overpopulation, which is happening every now and then, and of Nigeria, which make the government and other measures are not able to meet their demand. So these 4 or 5 problems are extremely important for somebody to be, to listen to it. My message for them is one: you have to sit down together, you have to make the strategy on the local level, on the regional level, on the national level, on the federal level. You cannot actually plan your program in isolation from sitting down with other organizations in your area, on your village, or in your town, or in your city, or in your province, or in your districts. You can't. It becomes, for me, if I'm considering myself as a social mufti, not religious mufti, social mufti, it's haram from the social point of view.
Okay.
That you plan in this area, in isolation from the other 10 or 20 organizations there without telling them. So you are wasting the resources of the poor people. You are draining the resources of the local community and the international community because you are not coordinated. This is the message. The message is that by both hands, right and left, work together, building bridges, building partnership, and showing the humility to build the community. Showing the humility to build the community. Why? I should not be seen as I am the first. I should not be seen that actually my logo, my organization, comes before the other organization. This is no. It's out of the question, not anymore benefiting the local community. So this is the message for the people of tomorrow in the meeting, and this is the message for the youth, and this is the message for the citizens, and this is the message for the government. The government has to create a mechanism to let organizations to sit together and to help the government to find local solution for national problems, or local solution for global problems, or local solution for the climate change, because all the global problems have an element of local solution.
Thank you, sir. Are you now frustrated somehow if you look at the situation, making a lot of effort on the humanitarian ground to solve the problem of humanities, and it is called the political will or the political power are not being much to solve this problem? They are causing crisis here and crisis there. What would be your advice to the political class?
Problems affecting different countries and different regions is partly because of politics, partly because of actually lack of understanding of the needs of the local community, partly because of the expansion of certain groups who need to overcome other groups. All this problem is happening because of ignorance, because of corruption, and because of influence of foreign players on the local governments and local community itself. Because of the misunderstanding of the religion, whom we interpreted differently. Because we are, instead of preaching peace, we are preaching hate. All these issues happening here and there is letting us to see many conflicts happening in different parts of the world. Also because of the lack of resources. As we mentioned earlier, there is a growth of the population growth, and there is actually a lack of resources to meet the demands of the growing population in different areas because of corruption as well. See, all this is letting us to see a world that actually eating itself by itself and destroying different nations and finding the reasons and the logic to defend your inhumane attitude towards other minority groups or other cultures or other religion and religious groups and so on and so on. So look at actually, if I give the examples in China about the Uyghur. Uyghur were living there. It's their country called East Turkestan, or now they call it Xinjiang, which is the new border. Why is this ethnic cleansing is happening under the eyes and ears of the international community? If you look at what's happening with the Rohingya people,
yes,
especially with the recent crisis over the last 4 or 5 years,
yes,
and this is their country and their kingdom for the last, centuries.
Mm.
Why is happening? And more than 1 million people are living in Bangladesh in this very dire situation. If you look at different conflict zones, such as in Yemen or such as in Syria, where the Syrian people are suffering. And how many people are suffering? Because of the interest, not only of the local government, but actually foreign powers want to control these areas as well. So when we look at actually what's happening in Kashmir now, and the change of the agreement which happened in the 47 and 71, and now it is takeover of the area, and this by certain government or certain political party, which against all the agreement which has been signed up by United Nations and by all the international players, and the world is silent. When you look at all this, what's happening in Central African Republic, Antibalaka. And people know what's happening there of ethnic cleansing to the Chadian, the Central African Party, and pushing them to Chad and putting them to different countries. What's happening here by certain groups of Somalia, as well as in even Nigeria here. Okay, all these sort of things, it's happening because of the ignorance, because of the corruption, is happening because of the lack of investment in the local community and the lack of building stronger civil society organization to help the government and to help the state to function properly.
Thank you very much. My last question is, sir, if you observe now the Islamic organizations, and like that of International Islamic Charity Organization, sponsoring so many conferences around the world, and they discover that in a Muslim world, they are yamming, you see children suffering, dying because of malnutrition, you see children in Syria dying, see children in Egypt, see children in Nigeria, Central Africa, and go on and on and on in Yemen, as you said before. Why can't they use this money to try to help these people, then to use the money for the conference? Does it worth it? That conference, does it worth it to spend such huge amount of money on conferences when people are dying for hunger as Muslims?
Okay, first of all, any conference organized is for a purpose. The last conference was organized in Kuwait this year was Feed the Hungry.
Okay.
The aim was to raise 1 billion meals. And alhamdulillah, they raised more than 3 billion meals from all the partner organization who came to this conference.
Okay.
Which this was actually an achievement. But your question should be, as I'm going to say it, if we knew that the problem is happening here, why should not stop it before it happens, instead of responding it and become firefighters? Unfortunately, Brother Musa,
yes,
the donors do not work this way, especially the traditional Muslim donors or traditional non-Muslim donors. The traditional Muslim and the Muslim donors give you the money after the disaster, not before the disaster. Give you the money after the fire burning the houses, or the conflict started, or the woman became victim of rape, or the mass influx of displaced people and refugees come out, or the famine started. Do not give you the money to prevent this. We tried this with our traditional donors. We failed. It needs us, Brother Musa and Brother Abdul Wasa and Brother Muhammad, to educate our donors, to raise the awareness, and to advocate for the rights of the needy before they become needy, to invest in the community before the community become poor and become helpless and become displaced and start to move on the road. This is what we feel. Even the international community, if you call it United Nations, others, they respond to disasters after the disaster. In a very few places that you find the international community respond to prevent, because the government do not give money to organizations to prevent, because they have other priorities. Here you are in dilemma. The dilemma, shall we wait till the disaster happens and we respond, or shall we actually preempt any disaster from happening? And this is what we call it catch-22.
Okay.
Catch-22 is, shall I educate my son, okay, or shall I let him be ignorant, and without education, and by the time he grew up, he will never know his rights in the community or her rights in the community. So education is a very vital process of protecting the country and building the country and saving the country and saving the resources.
Okay.
We need to educate the donor to objectively respond to, not to let the community to fragment and fall in a conflict, but to build the community and to enable it, to build the country and build the future of the country.
Okay.
Most importantly now is to respect the citizen, to empower the citizen, to build the local organizations, to increase, not to shrink, the civil liberty space. Without having a proper civil liberty space to enable everybody to speak their mind, to explore their potential, to build their community, and to love their country, you will never be able to build a country or a state, and you'll always be firefighter waiting for a disaster to happen so you can respond to it.
Doctor, this morning when I saw you, I would think that I'm going to see you very, looking very exhausted because of the journey last night. And now I will also think that as we are going to meet this morning, you may even be afraid because the road is bad. But you look so energetic. You are answering all the questions with energy, correct answer. So what is the secret? At your age, you are still active. What is your secret?
The secret is, this is always my dream, to come to Nigeria. Nigeria is giving me the energy. So when I look at the people here, smiling at my face, you say, look, Muhammad. Hamada, I call you Hamada. Look at me. His smile to me is an energy. He is energizing me. You see, I'm charging my heart, putting my he is the battery now. You see, I'm putting my heart in my hand here to take the charge from him. And this, you know, I look at this young girl when she's going behind her father to work. You see, this is a struggle. You know, when all these young men going to work here and there, these people give me the hope, give me the energy. See, this nomad was taking his flock of cattle and sheep and goat on foot, going from a village to village, town to town, city to city, to feed. This led me to understand and to feel that those people are far more stronger than myself, sitting in this pickup car, having a nice air conditioner in the car, and nice people. Look at those people here, how they are going. See, this man is working with all this big sack of, I don't know of what, of cotton or whatever they call it behind them, and in this very unpleasant road. But they are determined to work, to have a good livelihood for themselves and their family. You see, struggling. This woman crossing with her daughter as well. All this scene or scenery give me the energy. Give me the energy and telling me a message. These young people walking, they might be going to school, they might be going to the market, they might be going to hospital, they might be going to work. Okay? This gave me the energy. And when I look at the beautiful seeing in right and left about what Allah has given us of wealth in this country, this gave me the energy to carry on. At least I'm charging myself, cleaning my my thoughts, clearing the dirt in my heart, which from sitting down in certain countries doing nothing. So thank you for asking me to come to see the beautiful people here who are struggling very much to live a basic life that we are in the West cannot stand and live it. We cannot live without water, we cannot live without transportation, we cannot live without things which are essential for us and for the people here. It's not essential, it's a dream to have such a facility. This will give me the energy.
Thank you very much, Doctor. We appreciate the journey. Continue to Mina. If you get there, if you allow, you ask more questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.